Take this one home and make sure his mom knows what he's been doing.
I can help you. You're making a mistake.
The injured jumper. You sent paramedics?
They've already picked him up.
The blast in that building was caused by Bomb Voyage, who I caught in the act of robbing the vault. Now, we might be able to nab him if we set up a perimeter.
You mean he got away?
Well, yeah. Skippy here made sure of that.
Incredible!
You're not affiliated with me!
Welcome back to another episode of The Harbor. I'm your host, the Kino Cowboy, and I'm here with my other co-hosts, Scott Keith, Austin Casher. We are talking about a very special film today. Very special to me, you know, growing up, one of my favorite films of all time. Still in my top three superhero movies of all time. Two out of the three of my top three superhero movies are from the same year. God, I wish that superhero movies today had an ounce of the storytelling and depth of characters that these have. Anyway, we're talking about The Incredibles from 2004. I wanted to do it for like a 20th anniversary next year, which isn't crazy to say, but I was like, ah, screw it. We'll do it now. Because
why didn't we wait? We should have just waited for the 20th.
No, I want to talk because
we should make the title of this The Incredibles 20th anniversary. And then in like parentheses, actually the 19th.
Yeah. Well, it's, I just remember I have a fond memory of that Thanksgiving week being off of school and my mom taking me to see this movie. And this was during a time when Pixar did not miss. And it was like, okay, we're going to see the new Pixar.
Classic after classic after classic. I went with my family as well. I had the same situation.
And not only that, this was the first PG Pixar. And I was like, ooh, let's see what we have, you know.
This movie has some, for a kid's movie, some edgy stuff.
I would call it a family movie.
Yes, it's not a kid's movie. You're right. Thank you for correcting me.
I'm going to call it a kid's movie because it's correctly a kid's movie.
No, you say kid's movie, you think of like Paw Patrol, stupid stuff.
Yeah,
like
Trolls.
That. Trolls, you know. This is a family movie. Hello. This is a movie for everyone. And I will say it has some kind of intense subject matter at times. A very mature film for what it is. And
I guess I didn't realize this was PG.
It earns its PG rating in a lot of ways we'll talk about dramatically. Not even just because it's like crazy intense or something, but there are some sequences that are pretty mature for
intense themes that an adult can debate with another adult and with no child present, like we're gonna do right now.
I remember my mom leaning over to me in the theater and like saying like, wow, this is really good. And I was like, yeah, I just remember because it was like superheroes were still fresh and this was like even fresher. You know what I mean?
And this does get left out of the I think among true film connoisseurs, you know, which sounds weird to say because it's a Pixar movie, but this is considered a superhero movie, but I think to the average movie going public, you might have to remind them, be like, no, this actually counts as part of the genre. And they're like, yeah, I guess it does. Cause they are quick to judge it as an animated film. And because it is not based on a comic book.
Right. And it
which
feels
is why
like
it's good.
It feels like family drama.
It's like, yeah, one, it's got marriage drama and family drama. Those are the core.
It's like superhero action flicks, but like, that seems more of like a setting backdrop and not the full importance of the film, as opposed to this is like a family drama that just so happens to be a family of fucking superheroes.
I remember specifically my parents laughing at the highway exit scene harder than they laughed at basically everything else in the movie. And I understood why at the time, and I appreciate it more now. Last weekend, I was with my family on a trip to St. Louis to see Jerry Seinfeld and Jim Gaffigan, which is great. And I like, we got that because my mom was like, no, don't pull over at this gas station. And I'm like, I'm the one whose butt is going to be touching the seat. Why does it matter to you? She's like, it looks dirty. And I'm like, I don't care. I need to go.
Sometimes you got to risk those nasty bathrooms.
Sometimes like, you know, if I get hepatitis, I get hepatitis. You know,
we'll say that Casher is getting over possible COVID or something. And so he's got
tied from those gas station bathrooms.
But also Like, we've got the marriage drama and the family drama, but also the film is presented and it feels like a spy thriller, but with superheroes instead of like James Bond. So that makes it even more fresh to me.
Is there a word that you want to use to describe this film? An R word, like retro-futuristic. Oh, is that a thing with you, Adrian? I didn't know.
Oh, yeah, dude.
I honestly thought you were going to use the other R word. But
yeah, that was the joke. You didn't have to point out the...
Yes, it's got a very 60s kind of golden age of superheroes, leaning into silver age of superheroes kind of look and feel, because it starts in the 50s when superheroes are commonplace.
What years is set in? I think it's just nebulous alternate.
It's its own thing, because it has its own kind of technology, etc. etc.
It's closer to like the late 60s, early 70s.
I'd say 69, 70, maybe even 71.
Especially with, and I know we're not talking about the second one, but even including the second one,
yeah,
the discussion, the technology for that becomes even more like hyper retro futurism.
Yeah. We'll talk about that toward the end. Times,
yeah. Yeah. And like, I guess rewatching this as an adult now, I want to ask, do you think Brad Bird is an objectivist or not?
Objectivism is a very specific philosophy, and I know that because I familiarized myself with the works of Ayn Rand by playing the game Bioshock. And no, but I have read about Ayn Rand. I've watched interviews. I'm not reading all of Atlas Shrugged just because I can't even, like, if I had that weight on my shoulders, I couldn't shrug it off. That thing's so dang thick.
Casual.
Dude, that thing's thicker than Lizzo. Like, I'm not doing it. And, like,
you can't say that, okay? Lizzo.
Lizzo's proud of it.
I didn't say it's dumber than Lizzo.
It is. That doesn't mean
it's okay. No, it's funny because Lizzo makes fun of fat people too, even though she's.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's a whole. It's
whamp, whamp. When are we going to talk about the real.
Which actually, that kind of ties into the themes of excellence and suppression of excellence in this movie. And the raising up of mediocrity, which frankly has only intensified. You know, people see it as a conservative or libertarian argument, but I know it's such a boomer meme to complain about participation trophies, but at the same time, even though my argument is that the kids didn't ask for those, the kids' parents did, largely, I think.
You know, I feel like participation trophies have been around a lot longer than people are giving anybody credit for, and then just like sticking it to a more recent. Let me see. Well, who do you have the very first participation?
These are little leagues. I mean, there could have been a little league in 1950 where some random dad who coached the team. You know, these aren't highly intricate. It's not also FIFA. Like, there's not politics involved.
It's frequently associated with millennials.
It is.
Which is bullshit. The earliest mention of a term participation trophy came in 1922 in fucking Ohio. You can suck my dick, baby boomers.
All right. I'm glad we made it 5 minutes without cursing like Adrian asked us.
I'm sorry.
For going full on. No, that's a good time to bring it out. That's a time to bring it out. Hey,
the Rizzler in Ohio.
Fuck Ohio.
Dude.
Sorry, I actually really like Cincinnati.
That whole concept of participation trophy just makes me mad.
Now listen.
They've been around for 100 years.
Yeah. Now,
what was I supposed to do? Schools didn't have esports leagues back then.
He kind of brings that up. When he brings that up, though, it's he's also Helen's wanting him to attend his son going from like the third grade to the fourth grade, and that drives him nuts. But this is before he develops his character arc. So there is some gray there of, yes, I agree with Bob. We can't, like, I don't know. There is something there.
But at
also
the same time, a lot of the root of that, not to interrupt you, but to finish your sentence, is that it is that he's in a changing world and he's being a curmudgeon about it. I mean, this movie's about a midlife crisis. The main character is going through a midlife crisis.
Yeah.
Which is, even if kids don't understand that term, if they've never heard that pop psychology term, then I do think kids watching this movie, I think I understood it. Like, adults are out of touch with the zeitgeist in some ways. I'm 30 and feel out of touch with the zeitgeist. To be fair, I'm a nerd who at 15 felt out of touch with the zeitgeist.
My mom had a very, very obvious midlife crisis when I was growing up. around the time of this movie, but instead of becoming a superhero again, she got a tramp stamp.
Okay, well, they're heroes in my books.
And to be fair to him, it's understandable. And to me, the superheroes should not be subdued. I mean, there could be some sort of regulation, maybe. I don't know. That's gray area. But I feel bad that he can't do what he's best at. And of course, he gets into a slump having to work insurance. So I understand being a curmudgeon and being stuck in a rut. So
I bet tech bros love this movie, like the Zucks and the Musks of the world. I bet they're like, yeah, man, I'm an incredible. I can't let the government censor my genius.
Yeah, I don't.
Or they're more like Syndrome, realistically.
Yeah, I don't think this movie is Ayn Randy as people think. I think there's nothing wrong with boosting up excellence and not subduing people that have obvious gifts for certain things. But I don't think anyone should have to suffer because of it, just because they might be not as gifted.
No, and that's a common theme. And I forget what year was what year did Harrison Bergeron come out? That's a short story by 1961. It's a short story by Kurt Vonnegut that covers similar themes. You look it up. So again, just reference back to the participation trophies comment. This is nothing new. Okay, I'm sure you can probably find some student of Socrates back in the day who made a similar observation.
It's like participation trophies are not new.
Yeah, in the Olympics. Here's your participation laurels. Here.
Now, like, obviously the intro is important because it not only what does it build the world before you, okay, superheroes are very commonplace, but also Mr. Incredible, everyone's being interviewed. Mr. Credible is the one who's thinking about settling down and wishing like people didn't have to be saved so much. And then Elastigirl is the one saying, settle down. Are you crazy? Leave it to the men. No way, you know? And then of course she's become complacent with suburban life. And, you know, she's fine with following the new rules of the world. And there's nothing wrong with that. She's, I think, just as valid as following that as Bob is wanting to be a superhero. So
we also have a lot of these ideas that are in both of their heads at the time before they had kids.
Yeah.
And being a parent is not a unique thing, but it is a noble thing if you are giving up certain things to be able to raise a life of someone who's supposed to be better than you. Like, in all seriousness, parentage, you're supposed to raise someone who is going to be better or succeed past you in one form of another. Sorry, Dad. But it's like, it's one of those things. It's
yeah, I'm fairly
without without it's not without its own, you know, I guess heroic efforts there, but it is a little bit more tame. And I think Helen falls more into it because there's the whole matriarchal points of view.
Well, she's biologically changed by carrying two children.
Well, like, also I think there's a lot, like, I mean, back in the day,
no, there's, know, this is a very traditional nuclear family, and that's intentional. Know. It's examining those tropes very intentionally.
Then you've got like you've got the two retired superheroes, or you got Frozone, who's just living in a fucking penthouse with his wife who has no kids.
Is it a penthouse or is it just an apartment?
It's a nice, looks like a really nice penthouse apartment. Nice.
It looks pretty nice. I bet your superhero pension better be good.
That motherfucker has a conversation pit, which is my dream. Yeah. I want a conversation pit really bad.
Yeah. And it's like, yeah, I wonder what he did to get that kind of an apartment afterwards, because Bob and Helen, they have a normal house and like have to deal with some crap, you know. Obviously Bob is making enough to support the family, but still, I don't know. Frozone's got it made, dude.
I also do want to bring into the fact that this Incredibles plot line follows pretty heavily like a lot of other comic book plot lines about like the extinction of superheroes, which is what, when I first watched this, really drew me in. Like, those robots are just sentinels.
Yeah,
like, you think down, real down to this, like the simplicity of it. Like, they're designed to hunt certain supers and take them out. And the whole plot of Days of Future Past before, you know, Wolverine goes to the past is Sentinels are may cause like the Supes to be extinct, essentially.
No, absolutely. And when did Marvel Civil War come out with the superhero regulations?
Around the same time, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah,
I'd have to look. It's
I think we were well in the comics into the postmodern superhero.
This came out before what? This came out in 2004.
Yeah,
yeah.
This came out 2 years before the Civil War.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's like right around.
But this was definitely like a post Watchmen, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But in the movies, we had not seen, at least in the mainstream, any sort of examination of the genre, of a meta narrative of the genre.
Right.
Which
unless you count, what's that one with like, what's the superhero film that's got like Ben Stiller and
Mystery Man?
That's a little bit of. Which is the
I've seen clips on scenes on TV. I'm like, I'm not watching this.
We should do that for the fucking podcast.
Obviously the same caliber as this movie. Yeah. I will say watching
this into the All-Star
is fantastic.
They're in the music.
This has some of the best blocking in a CG animated movie I've ever seen. Like
probably what scenes? Talk to me.
And
I would say like some of the OG, like back whenever he's doing what's the fucking bomber's name? The French
Bomb Voyage.
That's all blocked incredibly
just
well.
The way, yeah, you just every angle, it looks classic, but it's so fluid. And I imagine how nice it would be as a filmmaker to make these digital shots that you want and can workshop it if you want, if you're not satisfied after you've already kind of figured it out.
You should play around in Unreal Engine, Adrian.
Yeah.
They're really pushing it for filmmakers and stuff, and it is being used in films. I think Disney may even use it for some stuff for some of their shows.
And the mid-century architecture really complements a lot of the shots and the 235, 239 aspect ratio. You know, everything's got rectangles and wide and very tall, high ceilings, especially in Syndrome's lair, like when he has dinner with what's her name?
Mirage.
Mirage, yeah. And just,
which is not a hint at all to her character.
Yeah. But Michael Giacchino, dude. Oh my god, dude.
Oh, that's him, isn't it?
Best scores ever. Like he blends that 60s spy sound with like heroic superhero sound perfectly. And if our friend Justin was here, he would be diving in on Giacchino. He loves that guy. And Giacchino, obviously, if you don't know him, he went on to do Up and many other projects.
Mission Impossible, which Brad Bird also directed one of the best, helped revitalize the franchise.
It was almost like a soft reboot. It was that like different and like good for the series.
No, and like you said, everything about blocking and the design and the character design being very distinct but very clean. And part of it was because the computer technology, the processing power wasn't there for hyper detailed scenes. But part of the problem, I have this problem with video games a lot, actually, but is that sometimes things become too detailed. And you're kind of like, okay, what do I focus on in this scene? Whether all this stuff, depending on the scene. But this is so cleanly designed and well blocked and edited, and every shot bleeds into the next, which is something you have to have a continuity of action and for the audience to understand the set when it's being established and blocked. And Brad Bird is a master at that. He really is. Did you see Tomorrowland? I heard it wasn't that great.
Yeah,
so I didn't
I've seen it in all of his films, and Tomorrowland is his biggest flop.
Mm-hmm.
The movie just has so many ideas and none of them get fleshed out and taken where they needed to go. And there's just so much loss of potential. The only thing I will say for that right now, because I'm planning on doing a video of where I talk about every single film based on a Disney attraction. But what I'll say right now is there's this absurd, stupid scene at the beginning where this kid is at the 1964 World's Fair. And he goes on, it's a small world, which was designed for the 1964 World's Fair, along with Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln. Those took animatronics way ahead of time because they asked Walt Disney to do that. Anyway, And he goes into It's a Small World, and like this laser like shoots this thing on his lapel, and like it reads it and like opens it up to this like thing, and he like slides down, and it's like this rocket ship and stuff. That's the shit. Like, that opening is so stupid and absurd, but that's the shit. And then the rest of the movie's mediocre. And his politics in that movie are way more iffy than the rest of his movies. This has a this rides the line of just right of like, okay, yeah, like we don't need to subdue exceptional people.
And it is because it's a family movie. It's not, and that costs however much, a lot. For the time, it's obviously not going to have any super polarizing politics. I think people make that criticism of him, but at least for this movie, you would have to be very extreme one way or the other to disagree with the thesis. No, the thing is, Tomorrowland, I heard, because isn't about all the geniuses go off into their own little enclave city? Yeah, that's the plot of Atlas Shrugged. That's straight up Rapture, Bioshock, Atlas Shrugged, whole thing.
Yeah, it just doesn't work. I'd much rather see Bioshock.
Maybe because of your woke bias, Adrian.
Oh, okay.
No, we just prefer the hard-to-be-a-god plot.
I just remember as a kid, you know, I was always aware of movies and ratings and like what was appropriate for this, and just I was always paying attention to stuff like that. And I remember when the fourth Harry Potter movie was getting a PG-13 rating, I was like, whoa, okay, this is crazy. And for this movie, I was like really paid attention that it was PG and that this might be a little bit more elevated than other Pixar movies, even as like a 10, 11 year old kid. And when it opens, you know, it opens with guys with machine guns shooting at the police. And as a kid, I just remember being like, oh, hell yeah, let's go. This is crazy. This
ain't Toy Story, bro.
Yeah, this ain't Toy Story. Ain't no Finding Nemo.
No, I was very aware of ratings because my parents were fairly strict. They weren't Mormon strict, but they were fairly strict about what I
watched. I was pretty aware of ratings because my dad had the top shelf in his room had a bunch of rated R VHSs that I was like, yeah, there's got to be breasts in one of these, and I would try to get a hold of them. But yeah, that was my only rate. But then I also, like, back in the day with ratings, just as a small tangent, I got so confused by the rating system because I also watched movies that were PG from, like, the fucking 70s.
And my parents were they adhered to the MPAA guidelines too much because there's, like, I had to convince them to let me watch Spider-Man in theaters. Or like Lord of the Rings, but then they let me watch Raiders of the Lost Ark, which was PG at the time. And they didn't make me look away when dudes were getting their heads blown off. Yeah. They made me look away for the Black Knight and Monty Python, which is just funny. It doesn't bother me.
That messed with me actually the first time.
But not with the rabbit. I don't know, dude. My parents are weird. Yeah. My parents would let me watch my brother play Medal of Honor, but wouldn't let me play it because, like, I don't know if they thought I'd be a school shooter. I don't know what their logic was. They're like, you're so more likely. It's like, we don't even have any guns, you Democrats. That's weird.
What I like about the opening of The Incredibles is like it hits you with the idea of, okay, Mr. Incredible has to be somewhere. It shows him dressed up in this tux, and there's that in your mind the whole time he has to be somewhere, but he's still having to
Barry Clark Kent Superman.
Yeah, but it's like there's like three or four scenes that all connect to each other, but they're all leading up to him getting married, and the way they bleed into each other, how he has to save the cat, and then he uses that tree that he just used to save the cat to stop the bad guys, which leads to the introduction of Buddy, which I will say he calls him Brody at first. I think that's a nod to Jason Lee's character of Mallrats.
It is. You're right.
Yeah. And and then right after that, the guy tries to commit suicide, and he saves him from committing suicide, which is kind of a heavy thing.
Saves him.
And then as soon as he crashes through the window to save him from that, he figures out that Bon Voyage is in that building trying to rob it. It just leads one to another. It really shows you how it's like nonstop shit being a superhero.
Right. It's absurd. Do you think that's a metaphor for police militarization and how that actually encourages violence in the long term in society?
I don't know if he was.
I don't know. I just pulled that out of my ass.
But we do get the idea of Mr. Incredible. He wants to work alone. The line, "You're not affiliated with me." Dude, that cracks me up every time because he takes it so serious, even though it's just like a 10-year-old kid.
Oh, he's mad.
Yeah.
To be fair, it's like there's gunfire going on.
Yeah.
It's like, get out of here.
Yeah. But, yeah. And then even after he does all that, he chases down another purse robber or, you know, petty thief on the roof. Mm-hmm. And Elastigirl got there first, and she, you know, complains that, "Hey, I was here first. I can handle it." So where were the cries of woke feminism back then about Elastigirl?
Because they like seeing that she later becomes a trad wife.
Yeah, but she's the one who goes out to save him.
I don't, because people, because Twitter didn't exist.
Right? Yeah, I know. Yeah.
The culture war was created by media 10 years later.
Yeah.
I didn't understand at the time as a kid why someone would commit suicide, so I was confused by that scene. I remember the first
and
time.
And now we understand perfectly. But now I'm like, no, you should sue him. Yeah, I would too. I would be mad.
That is like hilarious, apt satire of, okay, that starts the movement of anti-superhero. This guy wanted to die and he prevented him. Like, it's perfect to me.
And that's when I think lawsuits, like frivolous lawsuits, were really hitting the media. They probably existed before, but I think there's a lot of talk. Like, when was the McDonald's hot coffee case?
Yeah, everyone knows that one.
Which, by the way, if you look up pictures of how bad her burns are, not it's safe bad. For work, it's bad. Yeah.
No, McDonald's tried to sensationalize it to make themselves look better.
Yeah.
That was a media campaign against her, and it was very bad for that woman.
No, and all she wanted was her medical bills paid for.
Yeah, it's like that woman's got burned so bad that like she probably doesn't walk normally anymore.
Yeah, that was 1994. Yeah, she needed thin grafts.
Yeah, that's been around.
Yeah. Anyway.
It was weird watching the movie thinking that when this movie was made, Pulp Fiction had only been out for 10 years, and now it's been out for almost 30. I don't know, Samuel L. Jackson, you know.
Yeah, I watched The Mask this weekend. They came out, I was like, this came out the same year as Pulp Fiction.
That's
great. I don't know why we keep pulling Pulp Fiction into this.
I don't know.
Sam Jackson.
Yeah. Now, I will say, watching this time, I hadn't seen this movie in like 5 years. I will say there is, the animation at times does look a little dated, but it still looks great for the time, and it's nothing that would be, you know, it's fine.
It's timeless.
I just wish,
unless you're just going to be a, you know, douche about it.
I wish some of the city scenes could have been a little more filled in with people walking around and doing stuff, but you know, they did what they could.
Yeah. And that would quadruple rendering time.
I was going to say, thankfully there's not a ton of city scenes in this. Most of it's in like the fucking jungle.
Yeah. I bet that was hard. All those plants and stuff.
I know I was.
So yeah.
For Elastigirl.
Oh yeah.
I've seen some art.
They get married at night for some reason. I don't know why, but. And then, like, they take their masks off, but there's people sitting in there watching them get married. They're all in costume in their secret identity. So, like, that's kind of muddled to me.
Yeah, and then their lawyer is in there.
Yeah.
Even though this is before the superhero act. It's a movie. I don't know.
I know, yeah. So Dash not being able to go out for sports, and he promises he'll make it real close if he can to me, but like, what's the point? I don't get that. Like, why does he want to go out so bad?
Because that's who he is.
What, go out for sports?
And it's social.
He wants why does he want to go out for sports? Well,
crush your enemies.
Sports are fun for some people, Adrian.
No, I'm not saying like
not everybody has a disgust for fucking sports.
No, I'm and just may, saying I may, guess I feel
maybe
bad.
Hitting a baseball is not a superpower he has. Maybe he's a pitcher or something. I you don't know.
I feel bad that he there isn't like a league of like kids that happen to be fast or something that he can play with.
Do you think this is a metaphor for trans athletes? I'm not gonna go there.
No, absolutely not going there. No, just
maybe a league of their own.
To me, Bob is understandably one, the way he wants to go out in secret with Frozone and try and solve some crimes. His wife calls it reliving the glory days, I don't think that's fair. He also says it's reliving the glory days, but I don't know. I just feel like
sometimes the glory days were glorious for a reason.
He was meant to do that. And I don't know.
Well, I think that's what, but that's what this movie's about.
Yeah.
It is about.
It's like when he comes home after saving those people out of the burning building, it's like a perfect scene. And like he walks in and she's there already and turns around and she's like, is this rubble? That's such a good line. I think, you know, there's gray area there because those people would have probably died in the fire if you didn't go in there. And then there's the side of the glory days, like I said. And
would he have, or would there be, there's more, there's a ton of destruction that happens because he goes out and relives these glory days too.
He's carrying like six people over his arms at and same, out of the building.
Same time though, they have that whole altercation where he frozen freezes the police officers in their spot.
You know, Matt Casherson's, when do you defend police officers?
No, I'm just saying, like, there's a reason why she's like, you're reliving the glory days. Superheroes in general cause destruction whether or not they make saves.
That fire was already happening.
Yeah, but regardless,
that cop is going to thaw out.
You don't think that they're going to be able to get saved by the fire department at all?
Dude, that
may have taken a little bit longer.
No, that building was coming down. Are you insane?
I don't know. I'm very anti-superhero, guys.
Oh, okay.
Just saying.
They're like mega cops to him, so he's, you know,
you guys haven't, you know, it's just, there's a, that's one of the, that's one of the things that's becoming more popular nowadays with like superhero mediums that aren't Marvel or DC, is to really go over like why superheroes in general are a bad idea, or whether they are like,
they were in this universe, they were born with this. So why not?
That's actually part of the argument I've heard about superheroes and sort of, both superheroes and chosen one narratives in that type of archetypal storytelling, is that it's kind of like the opposite of Idiocracy, which argues that normal people do not do enough, which is really the argument of Idiocracy. It's not like everybody's dumb. It has a deeper layer than that. But I think it might have been Carl Sagan who argued against that, because he was very, even though that guy was practically a superhero, I mean, Jesus.
No, I guess the biggest point I'm trying to make is, like, I'm playing devil advocate here. Yes, I'm glad fucking Mr. Grubble, but it is reliving glory days because, I mean,
I think there's gray area there for sure.
It might be helpful, but it's not like he's going in there. This is kind of, it's fun for him. It's reliving something that is fun.
It's unfair that the government decided completely that there's none of this to be happening at all.
It's like Prohibition.
He is excited to go out because this is the only thing that gives his life meaning, and he learns that he needs to be more present.
Well, this motherfucker could go do something else to give himself more meaning.
He learns in the movie.
He shouldn't be shoved in the closet for who he is.
He learns through the movie that he needs to be more present in his family, which she says there that she needs him in the present. And
so, what part of this is not reliving glory days?
The fact that he saves people from a burning building.
So even though he's reliving things from his past that were glorious.
Yes, but
it can be both.
It can be. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There's gray area there. Because like,
just what's your hang up of calling it the glory days?
What are you talking about?
I just don't understand your hang up.
I really think you're harping on one thing he said that he was.
Well, that's what's bothering me. I don't know. You're like, it's unfair. It's called the glory days. Why is it unfair of that? Everybody has their glory days.
He's saying it's more than that. It can be both.
There can be a negative connotation that people associate with that term. Like, oh, you're too old to be going out doing drinking stuff. Oh, like in the glory days, et cetera, et cetera. Like,
were you happy when women couldn't vote? Like that sort of, you know.
To me, it's unfair that she labels it as glory days. Like there could continue on. It doesn't have to be stuck in the past. He can, you know, get back to what he was doing, what he feels like he's meant to do, what he's good at.
No, and you can do it. And you can do it with your children. A lot of people try to live vicariously through their children. And this, he lives with his children and not through his children, which is a beautiful thing. And the
what ideal... if Scorsese would have stopped making movies after age 60 because they tell him, "Oh, dude, you're an old director now. Let the young people do it."
Yeah, no more glory. If he had stopped after The Irishman, because he had the same accusations of the glory days, then he would have made Killers of the Flower Moon, which is one of the best of the year. It's going to be in my top 10.
No, it's a mid movie made by white people trying to make themselves look good.
All right.
You have not seen that movie if you think it white people look good.
The interesting thing about that scene, I listened to Brad Bird talk about the scene where they're arguing, him and Helen are arguing, and the first time they showed this scene to Disney execs, Pixar execs, one of the execs was like, "This feels kind of iffy. This feels like almost problematic in the way that Bob's like getting in her face and barking at her." And all they did to level it out is when she starts yelling, she starts stretching and getting taller than him to like level out the playing field. And then they showed it back to these execs and they're like, "Yep, that completely changed it and made it good to go." And I just found that really interesting because it's true. And it's also important that she holds her own and is equal, and it's not some, because I mean, Bob's a big fucking guy, you know.
Yeah, no, you, and they don't have that sort of relationship. They are equals in the relationship, clearly.
Yeah. So, and also it was to see them yelling like that in like a animated family movie, I found interesting as a kid. Like, it made it extra real to me for that family dynamic. It wasn't just this glossy kind of Disney kind of dynamic. It really made it real, and the kids
made you think. Does Mr. Incredible hit his wife sometimes?
No.
Give her a little pat?
Nope.
Yeah, maybe.
Oh, he gives her pats, but
I don't know. Maybe it progresses from there. If this whole situation never happened, you think he would have gotten stressed to the point where he would hit his wife?
No.
But
what I like though is that
we don't make inappropriate jokes on this cast.
Hey man, my dad used to beat my mom, so I can make the joke.
Okay. Well, Mr. Incredible is a very stand-up guy, and unlike me or my dad or your dad. So
my dad, I used to think my dad was pretty Mr. Incredible too. We don't know what goes behind closed doors. Maybe he's, you know, frustrated that Dash didn't get the winning pitch.
You feel bad for Mr. Incredible, especially when he has to go talk to his boss, Wallace Shawn, and Wallace Shawn has a thumb over him because, you know, he doesn't want to get fired. And there's that guy getting mugged in the alley, and Mr. Incredible wants to save him, obviously, which is kind of the inverse, which I like in Spider-Man 2. He sees that guy getting jumped in the alley and there's nothing can do about it because he's already given up his powers at that point. It's a cool inverse. And these two movies both have a scene where the character jumps on a train to stop it and stuff like that. I don't know, it was very formative for me at the time, you know.
Classic. Oh, yeah. The train scene in Spider-Man 2 might be the most intense scene of a movie I've ever seen in theaters, just because like it was my birthday and I had like other friends with me.
Yeah. My friend and I used to rewatch that scene over and over again.
Oh yeah, it's
perfect. Back before YouTube, we would just go to the DVD scene selection, you know. But I don't know. There's nothing wrong with wanting to use what you're good at or what you're quote unquote blessed with. But the real question is, in the real world, are people actually born with natural talent when it comes to certain interests?
Absolutely.
You think so?
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously. Well, with physical stuff, like, I don't know, I'm not dunking. I'm 5'10". I'm not 6'6". I mean, okay. So that's obviously true.
Of course people are. And that's why we lift people up like that and put them in where they need to go. But sometimes people never get that chance. And that happens all the time. It's just situational, I guess.
But I think it's deeper than that. Like, even stuff like Dash clearly has ADHD, or he's that kind of kid. And I think this was also around the time in our culture where pharmaceuticals, stimulants, Ritalin, were getting heavily criticized. Rightly so, maybe. Yes. For the wrong reasons.
Yeah.
because it is a very real thing, I should be writing an article right now. Because journalists is apparently the worst job for somebody with ADHD. But I identify with Bob, by the way, because I'm applying to jobs that pay less because I feel like I can't be who I am in this job.
Yeah.
And I can't live the life I'm supposed to, which is that of a, you know, joke telling man child. And I think there's a part of accepting people for their flaws and for their strengths, even though in the case of something like Dash, his personality is, as, even though it can be disadvantageous at times, there are situations where it works. And we don't necessarily, you see that most through running, but it just made me think of that. And I don't know, not everybody's made out for school. Yeah. And I while we're on the topic and talking about people's natural talents, I always think, like, I was considered smart in school and did well, and that's because I was good at writing and science and math and stuff. But also, I'm really not good at music and art. But just because those are extracurriculars, because our society just deemed those subjects less important, students who really excel in those subjects aren't considered smart or considered something else, even though I think that's a perfectly equally valid, maybe not economically, type of intelligence.
Right. That's so true. Damn. Yeah. And like, because you and I got to take film as text at school and a mirage of other things. And I asked my brother about different extracurricular classes there. And it's like bare minimum crap. And he's like, you got to take a film class? I was like, yeah, dude. And they had
my brother's taking like an AV class now instead of film.
That's cool.
That's cool. But it's just like, I don't know. Everything goes into football and,
well, you know, access is important, and that's part of the argument against these elevated geniuses. The example I hear is that Bill Gates, clearly a brilliant guy, but also he went to one of the few high schools in the country that at the time had a computer, because that's when a computer was probably the size of a room, I'm guessing. So obviously there's that, and when, especially when your brain is so plastic and you're really learning things. You know, I feel very fortunate that I grew up in a town of, at the time, what, 50, 60,000 people in Arkansas, and not podunk nowhere two towns over, where their programming class, they might not even have computers and might be writing code by hand. That's a real thing that smaller school districts were and possibly still are doing. Now that it's so ubiquitous, I can't imagine a lot are, but
it's like right after we graduated high school, all the kids started getting like laptops in the classrooms and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's crazy. I remember we had laptops you could get, but you had to check them out. Although some of that laptop stuff is really just, I don't know, Google wanting to sell Chromebooks, but it's a weird, I mean, sketchy thing.
Well, we got iPads when we were in school.
I don't think kids need iPads in the classroom. Not all the time.
We had classrooms that used iPads, Adrian.
I wasn't in any of them.
Quite a few of them. You didn't have fucking home ec or anything like that?
No.
I don't remember having iPads. Or,
yeah, I distinctly do.
You guys graduated a year after me. That's
all. I know, yeah. Castro must have been in all the cool chick classes.
You didn't have Miss Hightower?
No.
No.
Shout out Miss Hightower. I don't know who that is. But
no, she fucking hated me. Everybody liked her, though.
What's cool about this movie is, like, it's billed as a superhero movie, but the first big action set piece doesn't even happen until 40 minutes in. And for a Pixar Disney movie like that, that's a significant amount of time to go. And
the first
big action set piece.
It starts out with the action set pieces with him running around and with Buddy.
Well, I mean, you know, like where we introduced to like a threat within this.
Right. Sure. No, there's a long period between.
That's the introduction, you know.
I think that's one thing as a kid, I wished that this movie at parts, until it really gets the island and really starts taking off, I do think maybe the first act or first half of this movie didn't bore me as a kid, but I wasn't as enthused about it as I was some other animated films. I enjoy this movie more as an adult because I understand what it's doing more.
I like it about equally. I liked the family dynamic stuff. I don't know. But, and also the cool thing is, like, once he gets to the island and he does have that first threat. It's that giant robot thing. And it's not just a generic fight. It's with a self-learning robot. So it's immediately interesting. And he has to figure out how to beat it without being able to beat it. So, because it could have easily gone down the route where it's just like, okay, he's tired and out of shape, but you know, he's trying and he just,
yeah, there is a montage, but there's no kind of a training montage. But the point of the training montage isn't, I'm going to do this so I can get stronger and fight Ivan Drago in the end.
The interesting thing is, like, it's after this first sequence is that right, montage.
Because it's such a good joke when the robot cracks his back for him. I identify with. I work a desk job. Jeez. It is a celebration. He's already conquered it, and it's him regaining his virility because he has a reason to work out again, I guess.
It's like he finally has some success. He feels back more like himself. He's immediately happier. He's loving on his wife. He's getting back into shape. He's hanging out with his kids. Just immediately pulls him out of that rut. And I can't help but understand him there. Like, for me, it's filmmaking. When I was doing the Morning Line heavily, every time I would release a new short film and I would put it out onto social media and out into the public, that would make, like, the next few days feel really good because, like, I did what I wanted to do and now I get to let people experience my art and put that out into the world. And it would just immediately kind of boost my outlook on things and just my happiness. So of course I can understand, we've all been in ruts before, and when you get pulled out of that, it can be such a relief, and you never know which way.
There was about a year because of COVID where I couldn't perform. All performance was shut down.
Yeah.
Like, I felt I didn't know who I was, you know?
Yeah.
Not to make the global pandemic about me, but
okay, Bo Burnham, relax.
Ask for you. Inside's brilliant.
It insists upon itself.
Filtered. I don't disagree.
It's whiny.
A side note to people at home, if you know Sumner from either this podcast or from the Morning Line, he has a very strong take on Inside. And when I almost at first half jokingly said that it insisted on himself, he had a complete fucking breakdown and meltdown and was like berating me for the rest of the night.
What did he say about it? Let's do an Inside.
He loved that movie.
He loved it because he loves self-loathing.
Because he is Bo Burnham. If he were to, like, put some effort in.
Yeah, like, yeah, if Sumner was talented.
Grew up.
No, he's Syndrome and he's not Bo. Well, I think that's one of the interesting things, though, is that Syndrome has super intelligence. That's actually a fan theory.
That's the interesting part, is like he has the mind to create all this technology to make himself super. So what's the difference between that and being born with actual powers?
What's the deal with that?
He doesn't use them well.
Yeah.
Something I noticed on a rewatch is, this probably wasn't directly intentional, but Buddy is obviously a fanboy. And fan culture hadn't metastasized into our post-Funko Pop milieu. But he is absolutely a toxic fanboy who turns on... I mean, he is an incel. He's a proto-incel character.
Way ahead of its time.
He's not getting down with Mirage. You know he ain't.
Yeah. Like, no.
And that's even when he's talking about, okay, the robot's going to come in, and then I'm going to swoop in, and it's going to be like a movie. He has these fantasies and these delusions of grandeur, you know? And he is sort of that gifted kid who maybe could have gone on to go to some tech school and, you know, join a Fortune 500 company or whatever as a coder. And he was obviously very successful selling weapons a la Tony Stark, but that's how he got his money for all this.
Yeah.
But he ended up, because of all his inceldom and angst and emotional immaturity and attachment to the childish things that he should have left behind or at least recontextualized, he becomes a villain.
Yeah.
He becomes, I am become 4chan, destroyer of women's rights.
I love when he first reveals himself to Mr. Incredible. He starts trauma dumping and, like, tells his entire life story and what he's been doing to sell weapons to the highest, like, bidding countries. Mm-hmm. and shit like that. And the way he just throws it all out to Mr. Incredible, it would seem like at first, like, oh, this is really clunky exposition for the villain. But it's not. It works on all levels because of the setup earlier in the movie where Frozone is making fun of superhero and villain tropes early in the movie. So there's that setup. And so not only is that, but like right after that, Syndrome comments on that. And he's like, wait a minute, you sly dog, you caught me monologuing. It's a great line. And he has to stop himself. And then it works even on, I think, a third level, because that's what 60s spy villains would do. So it's like this fucking layered thing.
It's like the Ozymandias speech in Watchmen, where he's like, you think I'm some comic book villain? I launched the bombs 20 minutes ago.
Oh, yeah. He's like, I already did it, bro.
If there's a chance you stop me, I wouldn't be talking
to you. He's like, yeah, I'm explaining everything to you because I've already done what I'm telling you.
That guy's way smarter than Syndrome.
Yeah. But also kind of an idiot at the same time. I know, just another movie reference. I love in Austin Powers where he leaves Austin in the room. He's like, and his son Scott is like,
Scotty, do.
Why don't you just shoot him? He's like, no, I'm going to leave him in this room with a slowly moving laser and one inept guard and assume everything goes according to plan. And his son's like, yeah, get a gun. If you just let me go get it, I can go bang, bang. We can do it together. It'll be fun. I don't know. It was
good. Yeah.
Five movies.
Now, yeah, he wants everyone to be super so no one will be.
Great line. Great line of the movie.
But also, there's the added depth to where he says, he explains that he wants to keep it all for himself for a while until he's old. And then when he's old and he's been a big hero and an influence to everybody, then he'll sell off all his technology so everyone else can be super. It's
right. And that is, I guess, it's good that you pointed that out. I don't know if I thought about it that way, but that is a counter argument to the Ayn Rand philosophy.
Yeah,
is that, well, you can lift society. If one person is truly great and you let them be great, you can lift society up. The problem is when a great person does it for selfish reasons. You know, they're just some banker selling subprime mortgages or, I don't know, creating AI to automate people's jobs out of existence. I don't know, whatever. We'll see what happens with that. I'm a writer. And that is the thing. Although, then again, how much of the blame is on Mr. Incredible? Should he have been nicer to Buddy? Or was Buddy inborn as a bad seed? Was he just a bad seed?
I like that there's gray area there.
It's nature versus nurture.
I like that Mr. Incredible does feel bad and he apologizes and says, you know, like, I was wrong for being that mean and all that. But then again, Buddy should have matured and not taken that to heart. You know, sometimes you meet your heroes and they suck. I mean, that's just the reality of life. So, yeah, it's a maturity thing. I don't know. But we get into some of the darker subject matter when Mr. Incredible escapes from Syndrome and he gets into that cave and he finds Gazer Beam, which is funny to me as a kid. Gazer Beam.
Yeah, that's a good name.
But
good pun.
It's a dead superhero and he has to hide behind his corpse to avoid getting detected and stuff. And when he escapes this and he sneaks into the place and gets onto the computer, there's a brilliantly scored scene, really intense. And it actually gets pretty emotional and dark when he sees all of the heroes he worked beside in the glory days. And they've all been killed. And it just casually displays their demise on this screen. And he's just hit with all this information at once, watching all their names flash up as they've been killed. And meanwhile, this whole sequence is juxtaposed with Helen talking with Edna. And she's finally figuring out that her husband's been lying to her and she doesn't even know where he is. And all of this information is being explained to us just in this one sequence. And that music is so good. It's become like a TikTok trend. And
that scene's been parodied and memed upon. I've seen videos.
Yeah.
I can't name one off the top of my head, but it's a perfect scene.
But it is,
imagine, like, if you went onto Facebook and you saw like 12 of your friends from high school died all in the same week. You know, that'd be, I mean, I'd be happy because I hated high school, but you guys had fun in high school.
I just think Brad Bird knows how to make things feel very important, very powerful with just, I don't know, the editing too, how it just clicks between those. It uses the sound effect of the when it pops up, like, yeah, every single time. And then the editing right after that, where he gets caught in that room and those like black blobs like take him over. There's one point where it's like 20 different shots in like 2 seconds.
Yeah, it's 4 or 5 cuts a second, something like that. Yeah,
it's crazy.
But it's interesting. It does it. Imagine seeing that in theaters. It's muted colors. It's all black and white. So I guess you don't have as much of a seizure risk because of that.
It's just this kind of powerful storytelling is not as present in today's superhero films, I feel.
No,
like,
because they're not concerned with telling a self-contained story,
right? And
that's my problem with serialized storytelling. There's a lot of strengths. You can tell longer and more complex stories, but there has to be a cutoff for a story. A story has an end, and that's my problem with a lot of television series, especially old cable series. Now they don't let shows finish.
I think thematically this movie was very formative to me and very impressive to me as a kid that a quote unquote kids movie could go so hard and be so serious and tell such a great story while still appealing to families. And it stuck with me for a long time because I've always been interested in animation as well as like family films and what it takes to make a good film within those restraints. And this is the perfect example of like masterful storytelling. And Pixar at the time, they were just cranking them out, dude. It's unfair.
Their run, I'm pulling out 95 Toy Story, 98. That's a big jump. Bug's Life. Also known as Seven Samurai. Toy Story 2, 99. That might be my favorite one. Monsters Inc., 01, 03, Finding Nemo, 04, The Incredibles, Cars, 06. There we go.
No. Cars is like a small dip, but then you get right after it, Ratatouille, another Brad Bird movie.
Ratatouille, Wall-E, which might
and
be
then
my
Wall-E,
favorite.
And then
Toy Story 3, then Cars 2.
That's Toy Story 3 is the peak, and then Cars 2 came out, and I remember being shocked. I remember looking at the Rotten Tomatoes score at school with Casher and our friend Braden and being like, what the hell? That was crazy.
Yeah, I think that's combo breaker. I saw that.
Yeah. memebase.com.
I think that's what 10 movies, most of which are considered classics.
Yeah.
And Toy Story is one of the most important movies ever made. In 15 years. I can't think of any other studio, period, live action or otherwise, that has had that run. Maybe Ghibli. You know, that's maybe Golden Age Walt Disney. I don't know. Even then.
Yeah, dude. Know. This movie's so fucking good that it made me like choke up this time as a grown man. And sometimes it's because of the subject matter, but also because it's just such good filmmaking that I get choked up because I'm like overwhelmed by how well it's all put together and cut. And specifically, it's when Helen's going to save him and she's on that plane and it's revealed that her kids are on the plane. And then it's revealed that he knows her and Syndrome's like, oh, so you know who she is. And he sends out missiles and she's desperately trying to avoid these missiles. And at the same time, she realizes that it could be fatal and she's trying to get her daughter to do a force field, et cetera, et cetera. And the whole time, Mr. Incredible is powerless, caught. He's tied up basically in that electrical thing. And basically he listens to what he thinks is his family be killed in a plane crash. And that's intense subject matter. And that scene alone has more emotional depth than 99% of the movies that come out today.
Yeah.
And the way he grabs Mirage and like threatens to kill her and he has nothing left. And then Syndrome is like interested to see it happen. the fact that he thinks his entire family's dead and he still can't kill her, that to me is like one of the best examples of a true superhero. And it's very devastating, but also very powerful.
It is that thing where I've gotten so tired of dark and morally gray superheroes. I kind of just want superheroes to be superheroes.
Yeah.
I want whatever James Gunn's Superman movie is. I think he will do this. I want him to be a Boy Scout. I'm not saying he can't struggle with certain things internally, but I don't want him snapping Zod's neck. I want him like saving children from a fire.
If anybody's going to give us that, it's going to be James Gunn. That
yeah, dude's... for sure.
Also, shout out to My Adventures with Superman, that show that came out.
Fire.
It's got some growing pains, I think, but it's a great show for Superman. And refreshing.
I think this movie has
become retroactively refreshing.
Well, I do want to mention that superhero fatigue has hit our mainstream media now with how popular The Boys has been, and them having a spinoff that has been equally as popular. And then we also have Invincible now that is about to completely change the way we look at multiverse things if it follows the comic books like it was supposed to. And then we have things like the Umbrella Academy getting its final season, and just more and more superhero films that like are supposed to subvert the norm type things that are coming out. Hopefully we don't get like an influx of those.
Yeah, but they've been trying to subvert it for years now.
I agree. We had watch that movie Super. We had Kick-Ass and stuff. That's why I'm even bored with subversions.
At one point, Nolan's
Batman was subversion.
Should watch The Boys.
And it's like, I don't have any interest in The Boys.
You
can subvert all you want. I'm even tired with subversions. And then they tried to supplement that with multiversal stuff, and now I'm tired of multiversal stuff. So
this is not well done.
What The Boys does is it makes you on the side of fuck all superheroes to The Boys, and then by the end of Gen V, you're not sure which side you're on.
Well, the past 20 years of Hollywood have made me say fuck all heroes, superheroes, so I don't know.
That's fine. I don't want to talk about it ever again. Sorry, I talked about anything I like ever.
Well, this isn't a boys podcast, dickhead. The Boys. I'm fucking burnt out on
superheroes. Stop talking about it.
We dim okay. boys.
So the scene where he's crying over his dead family and she's desperately crying out over the radio to like disengage is probably better than any episode of the fucking Boys. That's real.
Okay, we're just gonna keep on harping on it when I ask you not to. That's fine.
Does he eat a baby in the show? Does he eat a baby? I know.
Anyway,
next time,
obviously, Helen, Elastigirl survives, and the kids survive, and they get over to the island. And when she goes to infiltrate the facility, she gets stuck between three different doors, which is a good comedic sequence. And then when she gets unstuck in the middle, her ass slams into two of the bad guys and takes them down. And I'd like to state for the audience watching that that's how I'd like to die if I had to be crushed by Mrs. Incredible's ass. I think it's only now, once Dash and Violet get on the plane, only then do we really start to get some development for those two, other than like the beginning, because they took the backseat while the marriage stuff was going on. And I like, because another standout sequence is when we finally get to see Dash run from bad guys. And it's interesting because, you know, it's really his first time he's been fully free enough to test like his skills to the ability. So it's not just a chase scene. It adds an extra layer of fun when he realizes he can run on water and he tries different things.
Awesome.
And he's like punching really fast. We get this chase sequence, but also like a testing out my newfound ability sequence all wrapped into one. And already, once again, ahead of its time, because a lesser movie would have separated these kinds of things and made them both less interesting scenes instead of combining them.
Right. And it also has that added character development it just makes me think of the scholastic aspect or even athletic aspect. Imagine how Tiger Woods felt the first time he held a golf club. I felt somewhere in his genetics, it just felt right. I think he had a dad who rode his ass, but guy's a billionaire. I don't care. I can't feel bad for him. He's like, he's still crushing it. He's like in his 50s. Or, you know, or when MJ picked up a basketball for the first time, or when Hendrix found a guitar out of the dumpster. Like, it's just one of those moments.
Yeah.
It's beautiful to watch.
And it's like really only the last 45 minutes that those two get spotlight, and Violet gets to figure out some stuff too. But it's like they get all these little character moments without taking away from the action. And I think that's really cool. And there's a whole undercurrent of like, Bob's lying to his wife, but it's not because he's having an affair or anything. It's because he wants to be a superhero again. But they kind of play that up and kind of treat it like it would be something that he might be lying about. So when she finally shows up and he's like hugging Mirage because she's like helping him escape, it's a good like final confrontation.
I think it's one of those things. You could argue that the sort of infidelity subplot or angle goes nowhere, but I think the fact that it goes nowhere, Mirage does turn around and help them because she realizes her boss is a tech bro, but B, it shows how strong their marriage is. I think it reinforces that, the fact that it does come full circle, that it doesn't veer off. That's the point of it.
And she's trying to like argue.
The fact that it doesn't change anything is why it matters.
And I like that she's trying to argue right after that, but he's just happy, so happy that his family's alive that he can't even like go along with it. He's just like, hell yeah, y'all are still here, you know? And it's fascinating that there's only 25 minutes left in the movie, and it's not until that point that we finally have all of the family together to fight in one action sequence. And that's, I think, a great build-up and payoff, because we didn't, you know, I don't know. It's a great build-up.
No, and the shot, it's only second and a half long, of the four of them standing together about to fight all those guys.
Yeah.
That's that Avenger circle shot with all of them in a row, but,
yeah,
you know, seven years prior.
Yeah.
Perfect. Beautiful. You know, this is the best Fantastic Four movie easily.
Yeah, for sure. And I'd say just the sequence of Dash running and figuring out his powers is better than any other fast running superhero sequence I've seen.
Yeah, probably.
I do like in Days of Future Past.
In Days of Future Past, yeah. You know, it's good, but it doesn't have, it's cool. It's, look at these cool special effects, but it doesn't have the emotional depth or the character.
It's funny. But also, we already got that scene in Futurama where Fry drinks 300 cups of coffee. So, you know, which is funnier to me. But, yeah. And so, yeah, Syndrome goes off to try and make himself look like a cool hero. And I like that as soon as he tries, the obvious idea of like, why didn't you set up this robot to not go after you is so funny, because it immediately like takes him down. And he's like, oh shit.
Or why is there no like remote deactivation that your guys at the base can like self-destruct it or something?
Because that's what he gets. It's funny. I don't know.
He's a ding. No, he gets knocked out quick.
And then, yeah, like you were talking about at the beginning, we get that like very family dynamic Griswold family shit when they're in the RV and stuff trying to get to the fight in downtown. They just get to play off of each other. I kind of wish they could have played off each other a little bit longer, but I think you get just enough.
Get it. We got 90 minutes. We got places to do. We got to wrap this movie up. We're at the climax.
Actually, this movie's almost 2 hours.
Yeah.
But
is it? Maybe it's like a...
Which is nice. It isn't just your basic 85, 90 minute thing.
No, it needs more. Definitely. I've said it once. I'll say it again. 100 minutes is an underrated length of time for a movie. It just gives you that little, you can throw a few more, three or four more scenes in there to just beef it up a little.
And we get Frozone back in the mix. He helps shit. You know, it ties everything up well.
Super Suit was on every commercial, but also it's another thing my parents were cracking up at.
Also, every kid quoted like that scene. It was just like one of those, trailer moments.
And I appreciate someone, great or good, I'm your wife. I'm the greatest good you're ever going to get.
And I like that they.
What do you think she looks like?
I don't know. Do we see? We don't. I don't know. If, we don't see her in the second.
We don't have the budget for another person.
Okay.
That's not what I meant.
You paused there. It sounded weird. I'm just
another person. I want because I was about to say superhero. I was like, oh, she's not a superhero.
Yeah. Anyway, I like that they defeat the robot, and you know it's successful, but you still have the kind of final scare like you would in a horror movie, where they go back and he's just standing there ominously in the kitchen with Jack-Jack, because that takes it to a much more personal level. Like this whole film has been, you know, nuclear family dynamic, marriage dynamic, and then to take Syndrome and place him within their actual home really actually ties it together, I think.
The incel doesn't want you to reproduce. Doesn't want children. And he knows he won't ever make one, so he has to take one.
Yeah, like the final sequence where she says, Bob, throw me. And he throws her to save Jack-Jack. But we finally get the payoff of the no capes thing. And that's how he dies.
Yeah, that's brutal.
It's so funny. It is
brutal. It's harsh for a kid's movie.
Yeah.
Almost up there, but not quite with Tarzan, with dude hanging himself with a vine. Dude,
that's badass.
That's dark. But also the capes joke is goated. Such a good joke.
Like what? Sequence. There's so many payoffs to setups and jokes in this movie. It just works so well. And
that don't have to be, because it's not an obvious setup.
Yeah.
Which is such a fine line.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's screenwriting 101, but it's the most elemental thing, cause and effect. I mean, it's storytelling, but it's done so seamlessly. Everything fits together. It's like one of those, I don't know if you said, like those Japanese boxes that fit together and you can't see the seams. It's like that.
I want to know more about Bon Voyage. Dude, that guy cracks me up.
Bon Voyage.
Incroyable.
I almost called him Dino Mime when I couldn't figure out his name.
Dino Mime, that's pretty good.
Like Frog Voyage.
But that, yeah, is definitely playing off of like all the kooky 50 superheroes before they really kind of tried to make it a little more serious in the comics.
Yeah, some of Batman's villains, Mad Hatter and Calendar Man, and
Mad Hatter is pretty cool in the animated series.
Is
like
he
him.
Okay?
He's a fucking creep, like towards women.
He's a pedophile.
Well, no,
I mean, like that. In canon, he's a pedophile.
Oh, okay.
He uses his hat to bring kids. Because Lewis Carroll was a pedophile.
Oh yeah, source.
Yeah, he wrote literally read. Like half of his books, and then he has letters to like little girls about how he slept with them. Look that up. Lewis Carroll talks openly about being a pedophile. Yeah, like
we can't leave this shit on a down note like that.
I'm just saying, like, yeah, no, everybody, like all of Batman's villains, like the reason why they are doesn't like has something really creepy to go with.
No, it's very, very Freudian childhood trauma.
But like, if we're going classic villains, like we got the Joker, which is just
Yeah, or Lex Luthor's trauma is that he's bald. Superman made him bald, and that's why he hates Superman.
Lex Luthor's not a villain.
Yeah, ultimate. Okay. Cop. Oh, is he not? Are you a capitalist now, too? And you support cops?
Asher loves venture capitalists.
Yeah.
Toy Story 2 used to be my favorite Pixar movie, but this one to me has taken the cake as an adult. And it's not like it's different at all, like line wise. It's all like those OG Pixar movies are
same
all S
tier, or maybe yeah, something's all, an A tier, but this is an S tier.
They're all, yeah, those are
I,
all S tier.
Yeah, this is one of my favorites. This and like Coco are probably two.
I need to see Coco. Soul actually is one of my favorites. I very much connected with that.
I'd say Soul is like A tier. I wouldn't say it's S tier, but it's like A tier.
Yeah, Pixar. I would say objectively this is a better movie, but for me personally.
For me, this is like creme de la creme superhero storytelling. What superheroes, how it should present these themes. And same for Spider-Man 2 and then The Dark Knight, you know, et cetera, et cetera. The good ones.
Should inspire.
I want to know what y'all thought of Incredibles 2 from 2018.
I love it.
I was when I first saw it, I felt kind of let down because it was not as good as the first one. And I have that problem where I can be let down and I kind of don't watch it. I haven't seen it since theaters. And then I go and revisit it with this new mindset of, oh, I already know it's not as good as the first one. Can I enjoy it more for what it is? And so I'm going to rewatch it possibly later today or tomorrow or sometime this week. And see if I like it more, but it's a solid film, but I'd like to pay attention this time to more of Brad Bird's politics and what he has to say with Helen's character in the second one, because I don't really remember. I just remember the Saul Goodman and fucking there's some Breaking Bad people in it.
I remember Bob Odenkirk's in it.
Yeah.
And I remember the ending has to do something with a boat and that Don Rickles plays like a frog guy who belches fire or something like that. My criticism of the movie, I remember enjoying it. I'm fine with a sequel not being as good. I walked into that being like, I don't think this will be as good as the first. And I think it's weird to me when audiences get bent out of shape like that, or Anchorman 2, or pick a sequel. It's like, good.
No, I just feel like it doesn't have to be as good, but I feel like certain movies, it's like, why go out of your way to make a sequel this late or later on if it's not going to be in the same caliber, at least.
Right. And a large criticism is that it takes place like the next week or pretty much right after. No, it takes place right after Incredibles 1 because you deal with the Underminer, which it retcons the PS2 game Rise of the Underminer.
Which I played.
Did you?
Yeah. At my friend's house.
Yeah,
I don't think I beat it, but we played it. I think there was co-op.
My problem was I was thinking about that before this cast and didn't have time to rewatch it. And I had trouble, because I hadn't seen it since theaters, I had trouble remembering what it was about. And I had to watch the trailer again to be like, oh yeah, this is what it's about. So certainly wasn't as memorable. It was a good, but not as impactful movie. Better than The Good Dinosaur, I guess. I don't know. I didn't see that.
My thing about the Underminer at the end of the first movie is like, did all the supervillains go away too, or just the superheroes? And has the military been having to keep these guys off or what? It's not really clear about that.
I guess.
Or did he's like, okay, superheroes are back now, I'm going to come back.
maybe that's why Syndrome had to sell weapons. He had to sell super weapons to the government to fight the supervillains, but then he also sold weapons to the supervillains.
Yeah. I also like to think that the Underminer like accidentally picked the worst possible time to try and like rise up. He thinks all the superheroes are gone. It's like, oh shit.
Right. He's like, sorry, I don't, my satellite doesn't work down there, so I don't get the news.
Oh man. Anyway, that's The Incredibles. 2004, director Brad Bird. He went on to make Ratatouille right after this, and that became a huge hit. I wasn't as big on Ratatouille as a kid, but I rewatched it 2 years ago with Parker and I liked it a lot more. I have been a chef in my lifetime. So, you know, and that movie also,
and you're also a rat.
That movie also lifts up excellence because he's a rat and he doesn't have the proper opportunities to cook normally, but it's kind of the same thing. But
but it's also, it's advocating, government assistance because he's helping the rat. I don't know.
Y'all watch what's that movie called? The Iron Giant growing up?
Yeah, that movie rules.
I used to rent it a lot as a kid, I remember. Yeah.
Anyway, that's an excellent 2D animation.
Bring back 2D animation. Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll be back next week with I'm not sure quite yet. I want to have our friend Dylan Rodriguez, an alum of the Harbor, on for Under the Silver Lake. But since it's Thanksgiving coming up, I don't know if he'll be busy. So stay tuned for next week anyway. Thanks for watching. Good night.